Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to keep our afternoon informal. We have an intimate crowd. Matter of fact, why don't I encourage everyone to kind of crunch down into this area right here? Would that be okay? You guys that are over there, and you know, typically we've got a couple of college administrators up at the top, which probably says that in their classes, when they were in, you know, when they're professors, they yelled at their students for being in the back row. So come on, model behavior that says, you know, you're engaged and you're involved with this. And I could expect the cops to sit over here somewhere, but you guys, I expect to be down here in front. Well, a little disappointing that we don't have more students here. We were hoping to draw students, if no other reason, for extra credit assignments, but looks like that didn't happen either. So they'll miss out on a very informative afternoon, I'm sure. For you folks that don't know me, I'm Ron Lowenberg. I happen to be the Dean and Director of the Criminal Justice Training Center and responsible for developing partnerships with other disciplines on campus, among other things. And a number of years ago, I had the privilege and honor of meeting Fran, who I'll introduce in a few moments, in our peace studies. And the fact that we train peace officers over at the Criminal Justice Training Center made sense that we partner with peace studies. And that's been a number of years ago, and since that point in time, we've had the opportunity to work together on a number of initiatives and projects, all of which I think were very productive. And I think Fran probably changed my mind a little bit about things going on in our society today, and I hope that I've changed her mind on a couple of things that maybe she had the opportunity at least to listen to my rhetoric from time to time and make an assessment of, you know, what the heck's going on, especially in the area of policing, which I know something about a little bit. But another part of my responsibility is managing and coordinating the Leadership and Ethics Institute here on Golden West College. We have the support of our college president, Wes Bryan, and we've had that in place for a while. And in fact, I'll be introducing Chuck Thomas in a few moments, who also helps coordinate that effort. I would encourage all of you, if you've not done so in the past, is to go on our website, gwclei.com, and take a look at our website. Again, that's gwclei.com. And you'll notice that we post information about leadership and ethics, and you'll notice at the very top on the banner is our mission statement, which states, LEI promotes the study, research, and practice of principled leadership and unwavering ethics. And I think that in a very short sentence defines our mission. And probably most importantly for you that are really have an interest in the area of leadership and ethics and combining those two principles is to look at the right side of the website, and it talks briefly about our twice weekly email blast that we put out. Some of our staff, mostly Chuck Thomas, with the help of other folks, goes through all the local leadership blogs and so on, ethics blogs, and identifies those little tidbits that we think we'd like to push out to folks who have an interest in this area. So if you sign up for that, it's on MailChimp. If you sign up for that twice weekly on Tuesday and Thursday, you'll get a little message from us about some things to think about as it relates to leadership and ethics. So please do that. Because we have a light crowd today, we're going to keep this informal. We're going to start off with a panel discussion and then give the audience an opportunity to ask our panel of experts questions and hopefully get a dialogue going. But they were smart enough to figure out that probably wasn't my forte. So both Fran and Chuck will do that. We'll help facilitate the panel. and I'll have Chuck and Fran introduce the panel. I mentioned Fran before. Fran is the lead faculty member and coordinates and directs our peace studies here on campus. An outstanding young lady, young, everybody's younger than I am. Seriously, she has a great rapport with students and a great rapport with staff. And most importantly, she has the ear of our president. So any of you that are involved in campus politics will understand why I mentioned that. And then our second person that's going to facilitate questions and answers and the panel is a professional and personal friend of mine. I had the privilege of working with Chuck Thomas for a number of years when I had the privilege of serving as the police chief in the city of Huntington Beach. I had the privilege of and the honor of promoting Chuck three times to sergeant, to lieutenant, and to captain. So if you like Chuck a lot, I had everything to do with his career. If you don't like him, I have no idea who he is, and I'll disavow any knowledge. But all kidding aside, Chuck brings a great energy to the center and a great energy to everything he involves himself with. So without any further ado, I'll give you over to our panel facilitators, and I'll have them introduce our panelists. Fran, you're going to go first? Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much for that enthusiastic the introduction of me and Chuck. I owe a lot of my enthusiasm and inspiration here on this campus from you, the support that you have given me throughout years, and believing in me, really, it has always inspired me to do well, and also look for guidance from you, that I come to you from time to time, and please tell me how it's being done. Thank you so much for being here. Yes, our crowd is a little bit light this afternoon, but for those of you who know me, it's enough for me to see apathy anywhere, and then you will have even more of my commitment to it. So if it was a big crowd, maybe I would have thought that, yeah, this is it's being done, and I wouldn't be that motivated. Now I'm really motivated to work on this subject because it is important, and it is a timely, really it's a time to talk about these things, whether it's a small or big, large doesn't matter, but we have to talk, and we have to build bridges in our community. So just the genesis of this event, what happened, you know, was the events of the past couple of years. I've been watching, you know, on TV, and the way the media had covered it really disturbed me, the way it was happening, the way media was covering it, and the way that things will happen, and all the attitudes that goes into it, and there would be dissatisfaction and violence and everything else for a while, and then nothing will happen until the next incident. And again, you know, the media is going to go there and not covering it, justly or fairly, and get some reaction out of people, and then, you know, it would die out again. So with nothing concrete in between, you know, it would just happen, you know, the same story would repeat and repeat. And then, you know, in one time also, I received this video or this clip from Chief, you know, showing me what happened in Oakland and how much people they were directing their violence or their dissatisfaction with the situation or their frustration towards our police, you know, and I couldn't frankly finish it all the way people were taking all of their frustration over at people that, you know, we'll look for our safety and security from them. So it is not the way to handle ourselves. So I was like really motivated to do something. And, you know, and so that was kind of like the genesis of it, that I thought that definitely we will have to have a conversation. Running it by our chief and asking him if this is a good idea, and he said yes, and then run it by our president, Wes Bryan, and he said yes. All the deans, they said yes. I'm not sure why they're not here today, but they all said that it's a great idea, it's a timely, and we should do it. And so we'll keep doing it until people show up. And that's how it's being done. So So thank you for being here. Thank you for being part of this conversation. I really appreciate it. I have invited a couple from my network of people that I knew. I had invited a couple of people that I'd like to introduce them shortly. But before that, there are also other people that I would really like to acknowledge here. Ms. Lorena Ortega, you know, she really put this program, all of this together. Again, for those of you who know me, I'm not a person who can administer things very well. So I'm really relying on her to get this off the ground. So thank you so much. And also the beautiful flowers that you see there, it's has been donated to us from our flora department. So we wanted to create an ambiance of soft and friendly ambiance here, and they provided that for us. So for that we really thank them. And for those students who are my students, I guess all of the students that are here are my students, extra credit, come to me and I'll give them to you. So for you will be like one grade up, for the rest of them would be one grade down. So,
there you go.
Just kidding. So to my left, my inspiring friend, amazing friend who has been a speaker to a couple of my classes, and my students love him, Mr. Jason Harper. Jason Harper is a private mediator and a founder of Harper Conflict Resolution, LLC. In addition to mediation, Jason is an alternative dispute resolution, ADR, consultant and trainer. Most notably, Jason is the ADR consultant for Los Angeles County Office of Education, providing mediation and conflict resolution services to 12 school districts and 22 charter schools. He has also provided mediation and conflict resolution training for the Western Justice Center and the International Visitors Council, training adults from over 20 different countries. Jason is a member of the board of directors for the Southern California Mediation Association, SMA, SCMA, as well as the SCMA Education Foundation. Jason earned his master's degree in negotiation, conflict resolution, and peace building from California State University, Dominguez Hills, and completed his mediation training at Loyola Law School in Los Angeles. So please welcome, join me in welcoming Jason. Our next panelist is my favorite student, Ms. Ashley Moore. She's a mother, an office manager by the day, a GWC student by night, and an animal rights and social issue activist, and a community volunteer in between. She is someone who listens carefully in the class, and then she takes everything that you say and reproduces it in such a way that you couldn't say that any better than she did. And so her paper is reflective of that, reflective of her listening and taking everything seriously. So please welcome Ashley Moore. And I will turn it over to my colleague.
Thank you, friend. Welcome, everyone. On behalf of the Leadership and Ethics Institute, we're glad to have you here today. You know, a couple people have asked me, well, what does peace studies have to do with leadership and ethics? And I would suggest to you that it has everything. My experience has been that there's nothing out there that goes on that if you're going to be successful at it, that there isn't some component of leadership about that. And obviously, you need to have a solid ethical base to be successful. So that, to me, leadership goes with everything. And I know when Chief Lohenberg talked to me about this presentation and everything, I thought, well, this is great. This would be an opportunity for leadership, for us to discuss the leadership a little bit more and about how absolutely important it is in all aspects of our society and everything that we do. So thank you for being here today. I have the pleasure of introducing two people that I've known for a long time. First, I'm going to introduce, on closest at this end of the table, is Rusty Kennedy. Rusty, thank you very much for being here. Rusty, for nearly 38 years, has been the inspiring value leader of the Orange County Human Relations, throughout the community, to create a safer, more inclusive community where everyone can live free of discrimination and violence, be treated with respect, and have a voice in decision-making processes that affect them. Responding to the need for proactive approaches to intolerance, discrimination, and intergroup conflict, the Orange County Human Relations Commission regularly address issues of intolerance, discrimination, intergroup conflict. The council has been in place since 1991. Through that council, Rusty has developed an inclusive, multi-generational, multi-ethnic, skilled board and staff to support this nonprofit's mission, which was crafted in his vision to unite and empower communities and promote positive change in Orange County. As I begin to read Rusty's bio, you can see why we wanted him as a part of our presentation today. He has invested years in building relationships and collaboratives across diverse sectors. His ability to de-escalate conflict and uplift equity exemplifies his invaluable gift for building bridges that could otherwise divide. When the Los Angeles riots occurred in 1992, Rusty guided Orange County Human Relations relations to convene the, quote, Orange County Together, unquote, a group of business leaders, educators, and nonprofits that examined causes of the underlying riots and determined strategies to prevent community disintegration in Orange County. Under Rusty's leadership, the Orange County Human Relations has become the trusted, respected local organization that helps facilitate a just and civil approach to problem solving, even in the face of divisive conflict. Rusty, thank you for being here today.
Make me blush.
I'm sorry?
So you make me blush with all those comments.
No, you know, I have to say, the first time I ever met Rusty was in 1994. I don't know if he remembers this or not.
Were you the adjutant?
No, I was the Crimes Against Persons Sergeant at the time at the Huntington Beach Police Department. And we had the brutal murder of a black man who was just doing nothing but walking down the sidewalk. And he was shot by a white supremacist kid. There was a lot, as you can imagine, there was a lot of concern in the community. Chief Lomberg was our chief at the time. A lot of concern about what happened in that. Orange County Human Relations came in and assisted the department greatly, so thank you, Rusty, on that. Our next panelist, last but not least, is a dear, dear friend of mine who I've known a long time, and that is Lieutenant John Domingo of the Huntington Beach Police Department. John grew up in Huntington Beach and graduated from Huntington Beach High School. He was first hired by the Los Angeles Police Department in 1989, where he was assigned to the Newton and then 77th Division stations, located in South Central Los Angeles. He has worked assignments such as patrol, surveillance, crash, which is a gang suppression unit, gunfire suppression detail, and special problem units. He's also a recognized gang and narcotic expert. In August of 1992, Lieutenant Domingo was hired by the Huntington Beach Police Department. What a great decision that was that we made. While at the department, he has worked patrol, the beach detail, the Oakview Task Force, narcotics, detectives, regional narcotics suppression program. He was a field training officer, neighborhood enhancement team, trauma support, and I could probably go on and on and on and on. Lieutenant Domingo was promoted to sergeant in 2004 and lieutenant in 2008. He is a arrest and control coordinator for the department, responsible for all department policies and review and training regarding use of force and the tactics involved. He has been an arrest and control instructor for over 15 years and is recognized as an expert in the use of force. He has trained hundreds of police officers and instructors and conducted presentations on use of force, tactics, and philosophies to agencies throughout the county. Lieutenant Domingo is also the recipient of the department's Medal of Courage, Merit, and Supervisor of the Year. John, thank you for being here. What I'd like to do, if we could, start off a little bit here. Maybe we'll go start with John, since you were the last one to be introduced. Would each of the panels take a little bit of time here? You know what the topic is about today. Would you take a little bit of time and give some opening comments that you have on this subject?
Yeah, first of all, I'm humbled to have been asked to be part of this. I think this is an important step in 21st century law enforcement as far as reaching out and becoming more closely knitted with the community and sharing each other's thoughts. A lot of the personal stuff, you kind of stole my thunder, so I'm not going to reiterate what you just read, but I have been doing this for over 25 years. Interestingly enough, I started off with an interesting gang of narcotics, and I quickly found out in dealing with people who are under the influence and who are pushing narcotics and the violent world of the gang world that oftentimes it could get very violent, even for the police officers. So my interest quickly was swayed over to use of force and the legal aspects in regards to use of force, law, tactics, and it's eventually metamorphosized into some of the best practices based on my experiences and some of the professors that I've dealt with. So as I'm towards the tail end of my career, my concentration is just on that, how we can do a better job as a police department and in law enforcement in using force use and educating the public on why we use force. I think that especially in the 21st century with social media, the media in general, what I call the video age, it's more important to educate the general public in regards to what they're seeing on the video. Because I think, and not to be disrespectful to anybody, but I think there's a certain naivety and ignorance when it comes to what people see. And it's completely different than what they see on TV and the movies. You know, we all like to think we're Marshall Dillon, but that just doesn't occur. And when you actually put forth the science and the research behind it, it's humbling. That being said, on the police department's side, we also actually have to make strides in how we employ force more efficiently. I'm proud to be a member of the Huntington Beach Police Department. As a member of the Huntington Beach Police Department, I've basically been allowed to implement my philosophies and my training, and I'm proud to sit up and say that I don't think there's a better agency in the country when it comes to force use and the understanding of law and policies and the efficiency of force. So that's it. How's that in a nutshell?
Perfect.
Okay.
Ashley, would you mind going next?
Sure. So I am a community volunteer. I'm out a lot with different, working with different groups of people. I'm a social issue activist and animal rights activist. At a lot of the protests, marches, activism I do, law enforcement is present. And so my thoughts come from you know, my interactions there, and most of them have been positive with the law enforcement in that regard. But more tonight, I'm very happy that Fran asked me to be here because the millennials, which I'm a part of, us, our current younger generation right now, us students, we are highly interested in social issues and the things that we've seen go on the past few years with law enforcement in our communities. I think in a way that young people haven't been in a long time. So I'm really glad that we're gonna have the voice of a student here and that I hope I represent them well.
Thank you. Jason, please.
All right. Well, just to echo the sentiments of everybody else on this panel, it's an honor and a privilege to be here and to speak to each other and to all of you. Just the amount of knowledge and expertise here is really amazing, and I'm happy to be a part of it. As far as the topic for today, I've done a little bit of work in Los Angeles. That's where I usually do most of my business. But I was also working with the Institute for Nonviolence in Los Angeles, and they were putting on a series of dialogues, and they called it Days of Dialogue, where they talked about, well, the theme was the future of policing, where in a lot of different cities, you know, all the way from, you know, from Pasadena all the way down to San Pedro, they were having different dialogues with law enforcement and the community, talking about, you know, in light of the things that have been going on in the news and the videos that have surfaced, with police tactics and all of that, what does the future of policing, what should the future of policing look like? And I think those were great dialogues, and I really enjoyed helping put those together and seeing how the police and the community were interacting with each other. And I think if you could bottle that and show that to the rest of the country, I think there'd be a little bit more of a, there'd be a little bit different of a perception of police and community relations, because I mean, I think it was beautiful how everyone was able to just sit and have a great dialogue with the intent to follow up and to be accountable and to move forward. And I think having this dialogue where it's two-sided and not just one, where yes, we want to talk about policing. Yes, we want to talk about the media's role and how things are framed and all of that, and the trust equity, and I'll probably be mentioning that a couple of times, but a trust equity that's built between the police officers and the community. But I also am interested and excited to hear about, or to talk about, what the community can do and how we can treat each other, and how we can make our society that much better and our communities that much better. So again, I want to thank everyone for allowing me to be on this panel. Fran, thank you very much, and I look forward to talking further.
Last, please.
Thank you. I got seated the extra 40 minutes for my opening remarks, so they put me last. A pleasure to be here. Thank you, Ron. I'm honored to be included. Chuck and I, great friends here at Golden West College and the Peace Studies program, and this really interesting group of people joining me on the panel. I'm honored. At OC Human Relations, we believe all people have a right to live free from discrimination and violence because of some aspect of their being, their race, their ethnicity, sexual orientation, gender, disability, whatever. And because we believe that, we work to create programs to create safe, inclusive schools. We mediate conflict and teach mediators. We also do that on a community basis in more contentious situations like the one that Ron called us in with, Chuck, with Vern Flournoy when an African-American man is killed. And we were able to partner with the department to really point to the fact that this was a hate crime and it needed to be called out. Even if the department couldn't at that time, we could. And we did that in partnership. So we build understanding between diverse communities, and we have a large focus on police community relations. So in creating the commission in 1971, the Board of Supervisors really set forth the responsibility to work with law enforcement. That's everything from police complaints, which we accept and deal with, reconciliation approaches and mediation approaches in dealing with those complaints, as well as just helping people navigate systems that they may receive some kind of response to complaints that occur. We do police training. I think we've been, Chuck, you might have been to one of our early classes at the Sheriff's Academy if you went there maybe 35 years ago. Maybe not, I don't know.
I went to the beautiful Golden West College Police Academy.
Oh, okay, well ours is, the Sheriff's Academy is a little more stressful.
Yeah.
We document hate crimes and support victims of hate-related crimes, and we educate the public on that whole arena. And we also work just in terms of helping communities develop, diverse communities develop positive working relationships with law enforcement. Like in working in Oakview and helping the department, in fact, I think before Ron, to establish relationships with the Latino community at a time when there were some misunderstandings, and it created a more dangerous situation than was otherwise the case. Anyway, in this during this time of national focus on the relationships between particularly African American and Latino youth and police and the confrontations that too often have resulted in violence across the United States and sometimes the loss of life. This is a really important issue. And I think for us, Dr. Bob Ross at the California Endowment talks about what he calls the preschool to prison pipeline. And that's the notion that kids are being pushed out by discipline policies that don't offer them a re-entry possibility. It's essentially, suspends them, puts them out of class, expels them, puts them out on the street where they're more at danger to continue in the negative course rather than a reconciliation type approach or restorative approach where they might be given the opportunity to repair the harm that they've caused. So I like, Dr. Ross's notion on that, and I think in looking at our country right now and the level of incarceration of African American Latinos, it's an absolute crime, and it's something that we have to. A civilized society cannot tolerate that level of incarceration and those kinds of that kind of wasting of life. So we have to figure out what it is that's causing that, and we have to work on that. I think that's part of what we're about. I think I say Black Lives Matter. And I say that because statistics imply the opposite. I don't say that to the denigration of the value of anyone else's lives, but I say that because statistics imply that they don't matter. And that's why I say it, and I think it's important to say. I got a call the other day from a woman. It was late in the afternoon, I was tired. In fact, it was being screened by one of my colleagues in the office. And I said, does she sound like she's got her act together? Is this just somebody who's complaining about something, from, I don't want to make a stereotype out of Laguna Woods, but somebody just going to go round and round on something, or is this like a serious complaint? And they said, yeah, I think you should talk to her. And so I met Anitra Chaffman, and Anitra began to tell me her story. And she essentially lays out this year experience in Yorba Linda, California, where she and her husband moved about a year ago. And she said, before we leave this community, I thought I should call and tell someone what had happened to us. Anitra and her husband were both law enforcement officers, advanced in their careers in the Sheriff's Department of Los Angeles and one of the South Bay police departments. And when they moved into Yorba Linda, they were awakened in the middle of the night when rocks were thrown through the window of their house. They presumed vandalism. They came out in the morning and found all 8 of their tires slashed on the 2 vehicles that they owned. They presumed vandalism. They went on to try to live this life. They were essentially moving to a retirement track, trying to get out to the country more, out to a nicer community, a safer community, a place where they might spend their retirement years. They did have one young child and a 20-something son. They learned that their 20-something son had been called the N-word while he rode his bicycle to the Home Depot where he was working during the early mornings and late afternoons. Their child went to the local Travis Ranch School. Anyway, I think that's the name of it out there. And he first was encountered by kids who wanted to feel his hair. And she said, well, that's natural and normal. He's the only African-American kid there, and he's different. And they want to see what it feels like. Later in the same day, he goes out to one of the kids that he thought he had started to make a relationship with, and he's in a group, and he's ostracized. One of the kids says, no, you can't play with him because he's black. And, one thing leads to another. Right before Anitra called me, she experienced their house was shot with acid paintballs into the garage door, and when the door went up, on the automatic door, the acid dropped down and wrecked a window and paint job on her vehicle. And she said, I just decided that I don't want to raise my 6-year-old child in this environment and have them be the one that has to educate this entire community about the different experience that we're having in the lovely bedroom community of Yorba Linda, where we talk about gracious living and life for some people. It underscored that life for some people here is different. And why is that so? We went, and she said, they moved 2 weeks later out of town, and it was just a sad story. We ended up listening to her and saying, the Human Relations Commission said, how many people are experiencing this kind of hate crime and this kind of harassment and not telling anyone when they move out of town? And so to answer that question, we went and we organized some listening sessions, as we call them, and it's a good police practice. One of the things we talk about, we partnered with a bunch of departments, and some of you may have participated, some of your departments did. I think certainly Huntington Beach, maybe Orange, I think Irvine, I know some others did as well, the Sheriff's Department. We had some listening sessions at the three of the major African-American churches, and we just listened to the stories of some of those parents and individuals and heard stories consistently of the fear that parents have when their African-American teen and 20-something boys go out on a weekend night. And their worry is that some foolish behavior that we all have at that age is going to put them in harm's way with law enforcement. And that because of who they are and because of the fears and the behavior, they're going to get into a situation that escalates and may change may give them a police record, may even result in their death. That fear is prevalent in the African-American community. The sense in the African-American community that we heard was that we're more likely to be stopped by police in any situation. We're more likely to be scrutinized and pulled over. That is absolutely pervasive in the African-American community from our listening sessions and our own experience. I had an executive from UPS tell me, about his moving into town. He's an affluent African-American man in a fancy car with computers in his back seat, moving in from his Midwest home to be relocated here in Laguna Niguel, being pulled over by the Sheriff's Department for scrutiny, not because he had anything wrong, but because he was out of place. He was an African-American man in a nice car in a predominantly white community, and what are you doing with those computers? You know, where did you get them? What are you doing here? Were the line of questions that he faced. So life, as we learned, is quite different. And I don't want to go on too long because I know I wanted to meet some of the people in the audience and hear what your questions are. But I think that you see in Anaheim the tension around the shooting of a Latino, many of them gangbangers and others involved in criminal confrontations with law enforcement. Some questioned over facing hostile questions over the scenario that ended in a death. We see in Santa Ana, law enforcement officers coming for their 25-year pin at the city council, and being confronted with demonstrators with F the police hats and F the police T-shirts and testimony at the open period about that the conflicts and mistrust that exists. Those kinds of situations, I think, are the things that make our community police relations in Orange County raw, as they are across the United States, and worthy of attention and scrutiny, worthy of engagement and everything from civilian oversight. How do we do that? What's the best way to do that in a way that will work? And from our perspective, the practices that we're most engaged in right now as a strategy is doing dialogues. So we partnered with the Santa Ana Police Department to do a police transgender dialogue. It was the first one. In fact, James Armendariz, one of our colleagues, our police community reconciliation specialist, is in the audience here, and he's one of the participants in that. And it was just an effort to really say, this is a community that has a lot of problems with law enforcement, and they have a lot of preconceptions. Maybe if we sit down around a table, share a cookie and a cup of coffee, and then talk about ourselves, we can learn a little bit and move this ball forward. We're doing the same thing in some neighborhoods in Anaheim with the Latino community, one in Spanish, another one in English. We have one planned, I think, for Santa Ana, another we're looking at in Irvine with a regional one with the Sheriff's Department, and that one will be probably around the African American community with Christ Our Redeemer, a local church there. Anyway, that's what I wanted to share with you in terms of what our interests are and some of the things that motivate me to spend this time with you today to think about this question of how do we build a society where we can create a safe community and we can do it together across all of the different dynamics of diversity that divide us so often and keep us from being safe. Thank you.
If I could just say one thing, Rusty, you talked about the dialogues that were taking place in some of the African American churches. I believe one of those was Friendship Baptist Church in North Belinda. And as a former member of that church, I heard about those dialogues and how helpful they were. So I would like to take this time to thank OC Human Relations for having those dialogues that were extremely necessary and needed, and it was really great.
Thank you.
I want to remind the audience, the title of today's presentation is The Role of Civilians and Police as Responsible Citizens to Create Just, Fair, and Compassionate Communities. What we're really hoping for today is that questions come from you. You know, we can stand up here for a significant period of time, and we can ask the panel questions, but we're really interested in making sure you get your questions answered. So right off the bat, is there anybody from the audience that has anything they'd like to bring up so far? No? Okay. Fran, do you want to go home?
My name is Joseph. I'm a student here. My cousin, he went to police academy here. He's top K-9 unit in Orange County. He's also African-American, African-American. He's had some problems even within the force, but I think it's got settled. But I just wanted some opinions, you guys, on the body cameras. Obama was trying to institute body cameras. What are you guys' feelings on that? Do you think it would protect you as a, you know, are you guys against it? Or just wanted to bring that up, that topic, body cameras.
Great. John, can we start with you?
How did I know that was coming? You know, I mentioned in my opening that the 21st century is the video age, and I think that is. I will say that, first of all, I can tell you right now, Huntington Beach Police Department, currently we are in a pilot program looking at the body cameras. I can tell you that it's not a panacea. You know, what you see on the video doesn't tell you everything that officer's going through. There are good things and bad things. There's a lot of questions that are going to be out today, and there's always going to be pros and cons. My fear is that people are looking at it as far as it's going to be the final answer to everything. It's either going to be, oh, yeah, finally we can get all the evidence on this crook, or yeah, finally we can get all the evidence on these bad cops. And none of that's going to occur. I can also tell you that it's very costly, okay? There's a fiscal component to this. I don't necessarily agree with the president and how he's going to be able to make cities purchase these cameras. And it's not just the purchasing of the cameras, you know, it's the software involved. Everybody's bought a computer in here, right? How often do you have to replace it? Because the software doesn't work. There's also a staffing issue in regards to that. In law enforcement, we have what's called discovery requests. Everything we do and goes to court is subject to discovery. Mm-hmm. That means you have to have staff available to go through all this video, okay, in relation to that. So that's gonna be quite costly. Do you wanna pay for civilian staff members to go through, as a community, do you wanna pay for civilian staff members to go through all this, or do you wanna put a couple more cops on the street? So it's not a very easy answer as far as support or non-support. We're in its infancy as far as the cameras right now. I think that from a law enforcement perspective, and I think society could help us out by slowing it down. Let's slow it down, let's take our time, and if we're gonna go to body cameras, let's do it the right way. So that's from a police department standpoint, at least my opinion.
I think body cameras are not a panacea either. I was thinking of the same word as you started your comment with. But I think they're absolutely a perfect indicator of a really crucial need we have for a conversation about police-community relations. And I think that they tend to give people, both the officer and the community, a new sense of accountability. And I think that's a positive thing. I think that people who are arrested make wild accusations about an officer, all the chief has to do, or whoever's handling it, is show them that little clip where they're doing outrageous things and saying outrageous things, and that becomes immediately apparent to them. At the same time, you can find things through use and the look at those videos that might help you to improve some of the behaviors that police officers are exhibiting, and the ways in which they get into situations that are difficult, and ways those might be avoided. I think they're good training tools. I do think those are challenging questions in terms of the cost. All that will come down eventually, but I do think those are major obstacles. So I would agree that the idea of slowing it down and making it a very thoughtful process is what needs to be done as well.
Yeah, and if I could jump in on that, I agree that that it definitely wouldn't solve everything, and I'm sure there's been other ideas that, you know, that have been widely considered. Oh, well, this will settle everything once and for all, and I don't think there is any one thing that would do that. But as Rusty said, it sounds more like a an issue of police and community relations. When you're asking for an added level of transparency, to me as a mediator, that sounds like there's a trust deficit. And that trust deficit can be met in a number of different ways. Body cameras being one of them, even though, you know, as Officer Domingo just alluded to, you know, finances are not infinite, and there are other things to consider. But in terms of a trust deficit, yes, that is definitely there, and it's more of a matter of figuring out how we can bridge that gap and build up that trust equity. And you know, whether it's body cameras or whether it's, you know, more dialogues or what have you, it needs to be brought up one way or another.
That's one thing. So I think in regard to body cameras, that what keeps happening is we are in the digital video age, and everybody has a camera on them, typically via their cell phone. But what happens is, by the time somebody realizes something interesting is going on and they should take that out and begin recording, you've missed the beginning of it. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, anytime if your kid comes home and says, you know, hey, I got pushed around today, I pushed somebody back, usually the first question is, well, who hit first and why? And we always miss that in these videos that keep coming up, because that was already done by the time somebody pulled it out. And I think what body cameras would do is they would give us that beginning part, and right now the videos that are coming out tend to cause more questions than give you answers, because you're missing that first part. And I think the body cameras would give you that. And maybe video could begin to be something that helps provide answers instead of cause additional questions.
That's an interesting insight.
Did we address your question?
I get it.
Greg, please.
This question is for Ashley. As I know, you are someone who do a lot of activism. You know, you care about a lot of social issues. What is it that the community is doing right, and what is it that the law enforcement is doing right? And what is it that the community can do a better job of bridging? And what are the things that the law enforcement can do better, in your opinion, while you're out there?
Oh, that's a lot in one. Okay, so I think the community is becoming more involved, unfortunately, because of some terrible things that have happened. But the involvement that we're beginning to see, I think, is good. However, you know, I think with both the police departments and the community, they're both a product of the environments at a higher level. So for the police department, for instance, you know, whatever their commanders tell them to do, pass down directive, they're going to go out in the street and enact it for the most part. And I mean, their morals and their values are going to be such that they're going to try to enact that in the best way possible. But oftentimes that initial directive, I think, is sometimes not the correct directive. And the community members, they're also a product of their environment. So unfortunately, if they come from a background where they're where they see it as having no choice but to possibly participate in criminal behavior in order to survive, they're going to do so. I think both for the police and the communities, you have to elevate the conversation to changing the environment. So I think, in my opinion, one of the biggest things we have to do as a community is we have to get money out of politics, because the money in politics is what's making the decisions about what happens in our communities and how those communities are handled and funded. And it's what's making largely the decisions of what the police department has to do. So I think the first step, no matter what you're passionate about, anything you're passionate about, you have to get money out of politics before you can see much change in it. There was recently a study done at Princeton that demonstrated there was zero correlation between what the average voter wants and what actually is enacted in federal government. None. The correlation is all between the elite and what they want, and organized special interests. And so I think that ties back to the fact that when we look at presidential elections, for instance, you have 400 of the richest families. deciding what candidates we get to choose from. At that point, they don't really care what candidate you choose because they've already picked the people that you get to choose from. No matter who you choose, they're already got one of them in their pocket. So once they get in office, they immediately have to pay those favors back. And that, I think, is what's driving policy, and that gets trickled down both through our police departments and our community. So if you want to make a change, I think that your focus, no matter what you believe, needs to be on getting money out of politics so that your voice can actually count. I'm going to do a little plug here for a gentleman named Lawrence Lessig. He's running for a referendum president. His intent is to get money out of politics, and as soon as he enacts the law to do so, he will step down, pass the presidency on to the vice president. So it's a long shot, but if you guys are truly interested, you can look him up, again, Lawrence Lessig, or Wolfpack. They're an organization trying to get money out of politics. But I would say we got to start there, because no matter how good the intent is of the police or the community, if you're in an environment where you can't do much, you're limited, you're shackled, no matter your personal beliefs, we're not going to make progress.
Well, Ashley, can I follow up on that for real quick and put you on the spot?
Sure.
You're out demonstrating or having your voice heard out in the community for some particular event. And I'm kind of using you in particular, but for someone in general, I think, like that. You're there, and the police show up. What's your first thought?
Well, I think with anybody, you have, those first few seconds that you kind of, get your basis of what's this person about right away in those first few seconds. And so when I'm out in the community in an activist, situation, it's going to be right away, usually the posturing of the officer. So often you'll notice that if he is going to be someone who's, doesn't really have an opinion in it, he's there literally to keep the peace. He'll usually choose to stand in a spot that is in between us and whoever, maybe we're protesting against, or she will choose to have a warm face looking at both parties. However, you'll have times where immediately the officers will go over and stand with the people we're protesting against and then turn and face us as if we're with them, not you. And so those things happen right away. Usually when they step out of the car, they're going to do some of those things. And that kind of sets the tone for what goes on. My protests and activism that I participate in is always peaceful on my side, because I usually have my daughter with me. She's very involved too, so obviously I have an interest in making sure it stays peaceful. But surprisingly, it's not always in my experience on the other side. So we've done protests against SeaWorld. They definitely have some pretty buff guys out there who try to instigate. They want to fire us protesters up. They want us to start something, so they will try their best to instigate, to make us mad, to try to get one of us protesters to hit them. In those experiences, the police often have been on that side with them. So I'm facing this tough guy trying to start something, and then also this police officer. And so that has been a unique experience. But other times I've had the police come over and talk to me. Sometimes I'll go to them. Whenever you're protesting, whoever you're protesting against will try to say, no, you're not allowed to be here. You have to be over there. You're not allowed to do that. And I know my rights, but sometimes I'll involve the officer and say, can you explain to them where I am and am not allowed to be? And oftentimes they'll be very friendly and they'll go to the person and they'll know she has every right to be exactly where she's at, doing exactly what she's doing. And that's really nice to have that support too. So I've experienced a few different things in that regard.
John, you
want to
follow up on that?
Yeah, sure. I've been involved in a number of different
And if you would, please answer the question, do police officers in the demonstration, do they take sides?
The honest answer to all that, we swear an oath to uphold the Constitution. Mm-hmm. That's what we swear an oath to. And so the Constitution, as you know, it's written in black and white, but there's a lot of gray to it. That's why all this stuff keeps going up and down the courts. So it could be the interpretation is different with every officer. Every person's different. Fortunately or unfortunately, in the police department, we hire from the human race. And every person is different. They have different competences, different strategies, different techniques, different styles, different personalities. I could tell you with me, and actually Chuck has seen me in dealing with some of these things, when I deal with people who are protesting, I make it a point to go over and talk to both sides. If you see me, and I can't comment fairly as far as what the officer did at your protest because I wasn't there. It would be, you know, unfair for me to comment on either way, either side, excuse me. But I can tell you that I know that in some protests that I've dealt with, I might come over to you if you're the protester and say, what's the deal? You know, introduce myself. I usually try to introduce myself with my first name versus my title because that tends to de-escalate things, except for some people, they just don't care. But anyways.
There's always that.
Yeah, crazy Ivan. But anyways, so I'll go ahead and what are you doing? Okay, just so we make sure that we're both on the same page as far as what you can and cannot do. And once I'm secure in that, then I'll go over and talk to you that said, hey, they have a right to be here, they have a right to be there. But oftentimes, the other side might be giving us a little bit of guff as well. So we might stand on that other side, not because we're in opposition to the protesters, but we feel that that's the best way in order to control it from escalating. Does that make sense? So, I mean, if you just stay in the middle, if you know this side over here is really gonna pop its cork, whether I agree or don't agree with them, and maybe they're the people being protested against, I wanna be close to them, sit there and say, that's okay. Because, you know, and I talk about this in a lot of my things, where we run into problems at police departments versus society is when it becomes ultra-emotional. And when it becomes ultra-emotional, it becomes completely unpredictable. It becomes completely unpredictable on behalf of the community, and it becomes completely unpredictable on behalf of the officers. Because remember, we hire from the human race. So we experience fear and anger and all those things after a certain period of time. I mean, we just don't put on our blue suit, pin a badge on us, and all of a sudden we become robots. I'd save on huge food bills if that was capable. So after a while, you have to be able to mitigate that on both sides of it. So I'm not saying that we don't have personal opinions. I think that every officer recognizes that we're sworn an oath to uphold the Constitution of the United States, and we do our best to put our personal opinions aside. But sometimes we just have to read the crowd and go by that way.
Can I just follow up with a clarifying question? So you're suggesting that the Crazy Ivan, is that the move that I saw in the Hunt for Red October?
Very good.
Where they do a little jog and then back and then
completely unpredictable.
Yeah.
Very good.
Okay.
When you started to bring that question up, I didn't know if that was going to be an Orange County human relations question, just so you know. I'm glad you got that though.
So just one thing I want to add in kind of on a different note about that, of what they're doing right and wrong as far as police. I love when I see police in schools, even at the elementary level. And, you know, if you're in a good community, you might think, why would the police need to be in there at the elementary level? I think in all communities, police need to be in there at the elementary level. Kids need to see that friendly face and associate that with a police officer and someone who cares and treats them well. And I've been seeing that lately in elementary schools. And I think anytime you get that at that level and then maintain it through middle school and high school, you're going to have people who grow up and have positive associations with law enforcement. And so I've been seeing that and I like that. One thing that I would like to see stop happening is, and I'm glad Rusty brought it up, the Black Lives Matter. I keep hearing police lives matter and all lives matter. All lives matter, but we don't need a movement. As a young white woman, I don't need a movement in regard to my relationship with law enforcement. That's a given. It's a privilege I have by being a young white woman. I don't need a movement. My life does matter, but as he said, statistically speaking, if you have to go to statistics instead of just believing the outcry you're hearing from that community, Black people need a movement. So that is Black Lives Matter, and I would like to see people stop infringing on that and going into these other conversations of police lives matter. Yes, they do. Stop using that tagline, though, please.
We had a couple questions over here. The lady and gentleman, please. Can we do one and then after the other?
Okay, my question is directed to Officer Domingo.
Sure.
Okay. you stated earlier that you have to learn to mitigate on both sides, both the public or the civilians and the police officers. So my question would be, for in regards to the public. How do we as public learn to mitigate our fear when a police officer approaches us when we're a person of color? Or how do I teach my son and my children, who are obviously children of people of color, to not fear police officers when all the media does is teach us reasons why we need to fear those who hold back and those who carry them?
You know, that's interesting that you make note that of the media teaches you. And I think that as law enforcement, I think this is one thing where I criticize us in law enforcement. And I know at the Huntington Beach Police Department, we're trying to do a better job. This forum is a perfect example of this. You know, and this is more my personal opinion, we have done a very poor job in law enforcement in educating the public as to their rights and the rights that they have and what the job is of a police officer, what we can do, what we can't do. I think we have to do a better job in law enforcement in getting involved in the schools, like Ashley says. I think elementary school, I think it's good to have police presence there just as a PR thing. And I will tell you that most of us have kids, so we get straddled with going to their elementary schools in uniform. So that occurs. But I think the critical part begins at the junior high school levels. Mm. I think we definitely have to become more involved in the junior high level on up. You know, it's interesting. You know, we're all taught spelling, history, arithmetic, all this stuff ever since we're five. Nobody teaches us the rules of the game. Nobody teaches us about criminal law. Nobody teaches us about consent and the Fourth Amendment and what officers can do. What is use of force? When can they use it? When can they not? When can you object to something? We're naive to all that stuff. So we kind of learn about it through our friends, which we all know how successful that is. That's like sex ed when you're in junior high, right? You know, you can't get pregnant the first time. You know, so I'm not the most politically correct person. I apologize for that right now. But it has the same effect. So what ends up happening is now we have young adults in their 20s and their 30s that they kind of have the half-truths. And they understand a little bit of what we can do. You know how those kids are. Hey, the police can't do this. I how do you know? Well, Joe told me. You know, and how does he know? And a lot of that's further from the truth. Again, here at Huntington Beach, we've done a number of what we call town hall conversations. I've given presentations at Cal State Fullerton. And we have a Citizens Academy that's been... Ron, you started the Citizen. How long has that been now? 20 years? 25 years?
150 years.
Yeah. But it's amazing how many people that once they see what we can do, what we can't do, what they're educated, all of a sudden there's a little bit more clarity as far as what goes on. So I'm telling you from the police department point of view, this is how we can do a better job, especially as cameras are coming online and everything else. And again, I would love to be able to get that education first so people know what they're seeing when they're watching the movie. You know, as far as the community, you know, how they can do a better job, be involved, ask questions. You know, I tell people all the time, I work as a watch commander mostly during the day. So, you know, most of the time the phone rings, and if it's not one of my administrators having an ape event, it's usually somebody from the community who's been stopped by one of my officers, and of course they're unhappy with the contact that was made. 95% of the time, they just want to vent. I listen to the phone, they yell and scream at me for about 10, 15 minutes, and then they thank me for my time, and then they hang up the phone. They just want to do an event. Sometimes I can go ahead and offer some suggestions on why this occurred. And then you have the other 2 or 3% that, you know, they don't want to listen to anything I have to say because obviously I'm biased, and I can understand that point of view. But if you're out in the real world and a police officer stops you, it's no different than walking into Macy's. If you're unhappy with the service, with the customer service rep, what do? You have to speak to their supervisor. We have supervisors rolling around the street all day long. If you're unhappy with how that policeman's treating you or policewoman, you say, hey, you know what, can I speak to your supervisor? And we'll send one right out to you. Okay? So, but the community has to become engaged as well. And I think it takes an effort on the community, too, to get to know what their rights are and what they're not. Not from a bias standpoint, just generally. When I was a training sergeant several years ago, I watched a video from the ACLU. And the video was titled Busted. And, you know, I always like to get into the mind of the ACLU because they're usually on the other side of the table. It was a great video. It tells you what the rights are of all your people, okay? I can tell you right now, because I showed it to some of my cops from a training perspective, they didn't like it. But the one thing the attorney says at the very end of the video is if you disagree, do not resist the officer in any way. The level of force, when we're talking about force issues, and I know I'm getting a little bit off topic, but usually we're reactive in that particular situation. If everybody's going along with the program, there's a court system, there's a criminal justice system in which we can go ahead and put everything out on the table and deal with it. I don't know of any cops that puts on their uniform and says, well, I'm gonna go out and get in a fight today, or I'm gonna go out and get into a shooting today. You know, that's not what we do when we're sitting at the locker room. So, and it's usually the last thing we want. So, I hope I answered your question. Okay, good, because I was talking a little
while. Actually, if I could jump in briefly.
Sure, and then we'll follow up. We'll do your question right after Jason.
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, thank you. First of all, John, I think you might have the quote of the day with the sex ed comment, but I will.
I'm kind of known for that. Just
that was awesome. I'm a fan. But what I will say is
my witness. My boss is here.
Well, one thing I will say in what the police are doing right, and I think it's been alluded to by Ashley and John as well. The police are actually going out and are participating, especially in Los Angeles, more and more, events with community members where they're just out and just, you know, having conversations and just, you know, out in social events. And it's what it's doing is it's turning it into a relationship again, where people are actually communicating with the police in an informal, relaxed setting. And so when these happenings do occur, where police need to be called in or involved, the police actually know the people in the community, and there's something of a relationship there. There's been some type of relationship built based on these little informal events that are taking place, and the people are just talking, just shooting the breeze. I think that's very, very, very important. I think another thing that that's mentioned is when it comes to building that relationship and that trust, I think what we usually see is it's a one-off transaction. Between a law enforcement and citizens. And, you know, and as a mediator in business, when you have one-off transactions, people can generally, you know, be a little bit more gruff. They have more, you know, license to, or they feel as though they have more license to be a little bit more unpleasant than they normally would be. And I don't think you have that when you actually have some type of relationship and some type of history and some type of interaction previously with that person. There's a little bit more care and courtesy involved. So I think that's something that we want to be mindful of, and I think the law enforcement is doing a better job of that as the years have gone on, particularly since the LA riots in '92. So also, I wanted to make a statement about what Rusty and Ashley said about the Black Lives Matter movement. I mean, for obvious reasons, I agree. But one of the common detractors or counterstatements to the Black Lives Matter movement is, you know, what about black-on-black crime? A couple things I'll say about that. First is that's a completely separate issue, and, you know, if you wanted to use the respectability politics, let's play it all the way out. So if black people are policing themselves, then what is the police there for? It doesn't really make a whole lot of sense. That's one. And two, citizens don't take an oath to protect other citizens. So I think that's also something that we want to be mindful of when we use the, you know, what about black on black crime argument. It's completely separate, and the fact of the matter is, for decades, literally decades, there have been movements, organizations, and groups that have been specifically targeting black on black crime. And so that has been going on for quite some time, and it will continue to go on long after the soundbite is over. So I wanted to be able to make that clear. So that's one thing that the Police Academy is doing correctly, and I applaud and I appreciate it greatly.
Yeah, sure, definitely.
Thank you for your patience, by the way.
Yeah, great to hear. That's what we're here, right? I have to disagree with that, first of all. Let me start with that comment. I
sure.
Think Black Lives Matter do have a lot to do with black-on-black crimes as much as the repercussions that are affecting the black-on-black crimes as well. I think there is a correlation that exists there historically, and I believe I believe firmly that if we divorce those, we're not looking at the entire picture collectively to understand why black on black crimes exist, number one. The other comment that Officer Domingo, you mentioned that there's this, for lack of better words, there's a sense of ignorance in the community with regards to education on people's rights. I think that wouldn't that bolster the argument to have body cameras in? I mean, if people are not, you know, sure exactly of their rights and not sure exactly how, what they can and can't do, wouldn't those cameras actually be better supported by having them, by police officers having them? Because then if something does go awry, then there's an argument as to why, look, they didn't know, that they didn't understand, and therefore this is how we had to proceed. That's that comment on that. My question originally is, what has the PD done in terms of educating its own population with regards to racial profiling? I think it's something that in 2015 in Orange County, I live in LA County, but in Orange County working in these premises and having been a product of Irvine, California as well, and as an extension of Orange County, what has the PD done effectively to further educate themselves with regards to that, to the issue of racial profiling?
Okay, let me, I'm going to take it in two parts. Let me address the body camera question first, okay? Because, again, I want to reemphasize it's a double-edged sword. And I'm not saying that we're against body cameras. I think we are in the video age. We are going to get to a system where I think society, the communities, they're asking for more accountability. All I'm suggesting is there are some negative things that we have to deal with first. In regards to how body cameras will not educate you as far as your rights, I think the education has to come before the movie. Sometimes it actually works against us because someone might see a video and they're so inflamed because they really don't understand the legal process that has gone on with that particular video. So next thing you know, they're on their phone, they're tweeting it, social media starts happening, and now it's become completely out of control when actually the video will actually ultimately exonerate the officer. Okay? But in the meantime, the damage has all been done. It shouldn't have had to gone to that. You know, sometimes we set fires and then the fires ultimately dissipate, but there are lives ruined in the process. Mm-hmm. Both civilian lives, community lives, and both police officer lives. Mm-hmm. I think that part of this forum and part of this education is so we're all on the same playbook. You know, as a law enforcement officer, I want to be able to say to you, and I do this in my classes, do you know what the difference between a consensual encounter and a detention and probable cause for an arrest is? Do you know where your rights stand with that? Do you know what Graham versus Connor? You know, when Ferguson hit, I was watching the media, and they kept saying about how the court systems ruled on this, and you heard about Graham versus Connor and Tennessee versus Garner, but nobody ever told anybody what those cases were. I find in most of my classes, they're not even familiar with that case. And that's the landmark case in which we employ force. So my point is that we owe it to the public to educate them as far as how we're trained and what we're trained to do, what works, what doesn't work, and then absolutely strap a camera to me and then go out with the same knowledge that I have. So you can look at it through my eyes, okay? So that's the first part of the question. In regards to racial profiling, POST requires that we go through racial profiling requalification and training. I think it's every two or three years. So as a department, every department goes through it. So we are constantly going through racial profile training. I know Gary Mays over here, my old boss here, he's done a lot of the racial profiling, teaches at the Museum of Tolerance. I can tell you there's a lot of ongoing training when it comes to racial profiling. That being said, okay, I know that some people will look at, I get this all the time, especially when I go home. I was stopped for no reason. There's usually a reason. Again, the education to society as far as explaining what the reason is important. Okay, you need to understand as a community what probable cause is. I tell people all the time when they get pulled over, I said, you know, have you ever looked at the vehicle code? It's like 4 inches thick. It's illegal to drive. I'm convinced of it. Between now, between the time you left your driveway and the time you come back, you've broken the law somewhere. You know, that's kind of my joke. And it's just a matter of whether or not that officer, and then some officers, like me, I was never a traffic guy, so I would let some stuff go. And then you get some motor who knew every law in that book and could find anything. Okay, so, but again, educating the public as far as what particular laws. I personally, my personal opinion is I think we have way too many laws on the books, to be honest with you, you know, because they're too hard to enforce them all. So, but as far as the racial profiling, that's what it is, but it does tie into the education. Did I answer it appropriately, or? You have a question mark over your head.
Well, you know, let's try this. We have Gary Mazza here with us. Gary Mazza is retired from the Huntington Beach Police Department. He was a lieutenant, spent 31 years with the department. And Gary is an expert in fair and impartial policing. Gary, would you mind saying a few words, maybe addressing
Sorry, dude.
Question? No, I mean, it's just great. If you want to come step down forward, whatever best for you. Thank you, Gary. And this is all, he didn't know I was going to call on it.
He didn't know I was going to mention him. That's all right.
In regards to racial profiling, John's right. The state requires that all police officers in the police academy get a five-hour instruction on racial profiling, what it is, what it looks like, and how to prevent it. And then they also require that all the police officers in the state of California go through a two-hour update every 5 years. And we're in the process of going through the update right now. So everybody in the state is going to go through this update. And so you talk about what racial profiling is, but like John said, police departments hire from the human race. And we all have biases, and we all have biases that we don't even realize that are there. And sometimes they come up and they can cause us to do things that we may not even realize that we're doing. And part of the training with racial profiling now is to talk about those implicit biases and how they impact us and how they're there. And we give officers, we give them clues on these things and how to prevent them from impacting us and impacting the decisions that we make when we interact with people that are different from us. We've instituted a program at the Gold West College for called Fair and Impartial Policing. And it's a program that is study-based. It's done by academics. And they look at implicit bias. And they talk about how it's in all of us and how it impacts us. And we give them clues. We give them things that they can do to lessen the impact. You're never going to do away with it. So those biases are always going to be there, but you can, once you realize that you have them, and once that you go through some of these things that we suggest to them, it lessens the impact on them. I have a friend that went to UCLA, he's black, and he used to tell me that he goes, if they drove through Westwood, they had to add an extra half hour onto their time because they were going to get stopped by LAPD because they were black. And that was his reality. That was his impression of things. And so when we talk about racial profiling with officers, a lot of the officers go, I don't racially profile. You know, I see things, I see traffic violations, I see things that cue me that something's not right here. Then I start looking for traffic violations. And it's not I'm targeting that person because they're black or because they're Hispanic. I'm seeing things that maybe the ordinary citizens wouldn't see, and it's making me think that there's something criminal going on here, and I want to investigate that part of it. And those things are allowed through the court system. So we're trying to address racial profiling. It's something that people think happens, and in their minds it probably does. And because we hire from the human race, it may happen, but we're really trying to combat that, to tamp it down, to make sure that officers understand what racial profiling is, and it is not acceptable.
She's waiting to be called.
Got a question over here.
Yes, ma'am.
Go ahead.
I think it's that the media covers more, I think that's really a lot with the media, it's like safer than the media, you'll see more what they want to get from you. It's like, don't mention black, don't mention this. So I think that kind of just stigmatizes everything, just kind of leaves everybody with a sour taste in their mouth. Oh, that was just about Mexican. Oh, that was just about black. And then somebody else said, they get the information from the public school. I think that they're so quick to not accept what they did and just run down that issue just to kind of, I guess, take off the responsibility that they did something wrong and just push the whole race card.
I think you're definitely onto something in the fact that the media and also our institutions reinforce stereotypes, and those stereotypes do have, like the implicit bias, I think, that you speak of. It exists, and it's called racial profiling if you're a police officer, because, and I think the efforts to train it out of you are noble and challenging. It's the same battle for all of us in the course of our work to figure out how to train out those lizard responses, those implicit things, those things that are reactions that happen faster than your brain kicks in, your it's instinct. And those are that implicit bias is expressed there before your brain can even catch it. So I really, the efforts of Post and departments in Orange County to train officers to get their brains thinking about recognizing when that's happened, figuring out then how to de-escalate that, that reaction is really an important thing. And I think that's something we all strive to do in this effort. It was try to create a police force and a community that can work together, in spite of biases that exist.
Yes, sir.
I just want to say, I don't think believing that the race card, number one, I appreciate what the gentleman mentioned, but I don't think the race card gets thrown in there for no reason. I believe that this has been something that the media has been angsting for the public to believe that race is no longer an issue, or concepts of race are no longer an issue when we talk about forms of policing and forms of brutality that can take place. I think that one of the most important things to look at is the different cases that prop up, the fact that it's still occurring, I think. And as an instructor, as an educator, as someone who teaches critical race theory, as someone who's been trained in that field, do you believe that 5 hours of instruction really creates a level of cultural sensitivity to understand different paradigms, different understandings of how cultures work, or how class levels work, or how why it is that maybe that gentleman who went to UCLA felt the impression of going into Westport or passing through Beverly Hills and feeling that they were going to get pulled over, perhaps because the vehicle was on a 2015 Mustang. And why it is that it's this, in your opinion, do you believe that, having 5 hours and checking in every couple of years to see how things are rolling around, do you think that makes it for an effective case to virtually eliminate racial profiling?
My personal opinion? No, I don't think so. I think you're scratching the surface, though. And I think what this does is it plants seeds in the officers, and it plants seeds in the departments that these things are there, that they could raise up. And part of the training is we throw it back on the officers. You work with other officers, you see how they're acting, and it's your responsibility to challenge them. If they're going down the wrong path, if they're acting in a manner that's not acceptable, then the fellow officers are responsible for challenging them, for bringing them back a little bit. Like I said before, the implicit bias that we talked about, we all have it. It's all in us. And like Rusty says, it triggers before you can even realize that it's there. And by the mere fact that you know it's there, it helps you deal with that. It helps it when those times come up where it pops up before you can control it. And you can go, oh, wait a minute, it happens to me all the time. And I kind of have to go, whoa, that's that implicit bias. And there it is. How I choose to act after that is up to me. And with the knowledge that you have it, you can impact that. You can lessen the impact that it has on the way you treat people, the way you look at people. And sometimes it just comes out. You can't control it. Are we going to change law enforcement? No. I think we're scratching the surface. We're doing the best we can with what we've got. We're planting seeds. And when you do that, in the back of your mind, maybe when the officers are out there making contact, it's like, wait a minute, am I looking at this for this, or am I looking at it from a law enforcement perspective? And it allows you to kind of analyze what's going on. And, we start with the academy, and we're training the officers, and we're building this up. It's slowly coming out, and I think it's going to be better and better as time goes on.
The other part of that is the huge challenge we have. I mean, you're recruiting from the human race, but you're also winnowing that down so that the people that get hired are inordinately, disproportionately white males. So we have some, there's a variety of reasons that is so, but because that is so, we are going to continue to have a larger challenge. I think as our departments become more diverse, we have more opportunity for people to spend time together on a common task and learn some of those, learn through some of those things, that the assumptions and stuff. And I look for that day, but it's very difficult. I think we need to look at our selection criteria, our promotion criteria, our evaluation criteria at every step in the matter. I think people are washing out in the recruitment process for a variety of things that may not be as related to the job that we need them to do as they once were. And it's going to take some of that analysis, I think, and change to bring about a more diverse force, including women and Latinos, African Americans, and other groups. Yeah, I know we had a couple of questions up in the top.
Can I say one thing just real quick? I just wanted to bring something in here. And for the audience, probably doesn't know, in California, there's an state organization, a Commission on Peace Officer Standards and Training, and called POST. POST is the organization that decides the level of training that police officers receive throughout the state. We're fortunate enough today, if you don't mind, I tapped into Dean Ron Lauenberg. He's not only a retired police chief and the dean here at Golden West, but he's also served many, many years on the POST Commission. Would you mind commenting a little bit about the gentleman's question about, is that enough training? And sorry, I'm tapping into another participant from the audience.
Thank you, Chuck. I was hoping you would ask me. I can't help myself. You raise an excellent point. And let me see if I can address it this way. The present police academy here at Golden West College is over 1,000 hours of instruction. We don't spend just 5 hours on racial profiling. There's a whole bunch of training around community policing, how we interact with the community, in addition to all the other stuff that we do as it relates to arrest and control tactics and the laws, criminal laws, so on and so forth. So let me see if I can put it in this perspective for us to better understand all this. I believe our society has become so complicated, our ability to deliver quality police service is becoming increasingly complicated. Can we train young men and women of all ethnicities, by the way? By the way, the police academy, you need to know, the demographics has changed dramatically. More women, which is important, because half the community we police is women, so we need to have more police officers that are women. We have seen a significant increase, especially in our region, of Asian Americans, second and third generation. For a while, we had difficulty in recruiting Asians to our forces, to our communities, for a lot of reasons. A lot of that was they came from countries where policing was corrupt, and the parents and grandparents of those, if their kids even uttered the word, "I want to be a police officer," they were thrown out of the house. We've gotten past that, so we're making great progress in that area. So can we train young men and women to be effective police officers in 1,000 hours of instruction? No way. But we gotta do the best we can with what we got, right? And so, As we continually examine our curriculum and our approach to training young men and women to be successful police officers, I think we're doing a great job. Can we do more? Absolutely. As our society changes, do we need to be flexible and adaptable to modify our training to address those issues? Absolutely. We have Rick and myself, Rick Hicks, our center coordinator, retired police chief from Placentia, is on our staff. We're having an executive advisory board meeting later in October. We bring all our police chief training partners together and we review all of our curriculum. How are we doing? What do we need to do differently? You know, what kind of a message can we get from the Human Relations Commission about how we're doing or how we're not doing?
I'll be happy to criticize your critique.
I'm sure you will. Wouldn't be the first
critique
time,
it,
wouldn't
I don't
be the last, right? Rusty attends the Orange County Chief and Sheriff's Association meetings on a semi-regular basis. There's an Orange County chief that sits on his board. So we need to keep the dialogue open. And again, is there room for improvement? Absolutely. But I think, I've got to believe, or I wouldn't be in this job, that we're doing a better job today than we did a decade ago, and I've got to believe we're going to be doing a better job a decade from now, especially in this area. And Gary didn't mention it because he didn't have enough time, but fair and impartial policing is research-based. You know, it's not somebody deciding in a dark room somewhere what we should be doing about addressing this issue. It's research-based. And so, if I have anything to do about it, say about it, we're going to continue to push racial profiling into the area of fair and impartial policing, because show me research that really identifies the critical principles behind racial profiling. I don't see a lot of that. I see a lot of research behind fair and impartial policing. So I'm going to trust the research.
Thank you.
Chuck, can I just, and this whole dialogue, this is exactly what I was talking about as far as the education of the public, because there's so much to what we do in the police department, in the training and everything else. And I mean, you have mental illness training, you've got racial profiling, you've got arrest and control, you've got firearms training, you've got the laws are constantly changing. Every time we have an election, the laws change, so we got to and eventually, I mean, our cops would love to just sit inside and eat coffee and drink coffee and eat donuts all day long, as we eat bagels now, but and just watch videos and be trained all day, but eventually you got to go to work. You know, we've got to go to work. So I know that we do the best with the minimal, the limited time that we have. So that's why it's so important that as a community, you know, we're your police department. Okay, tell us, how do you want us to spend the time? Do you want us out patrolling the streets? Or do you want to send everybody 40 hours or 50 hours of racial profiling? We're getting it. Because for every one of those 40 hours, then you have the mental illness people that come in, and they want us to go to mental illness training. You know, I mean, everybody's got a thing. So we're sensitive to it. And what we need is we need the communities to recognize, hey, kind of direct us in the right direction, because we can't do it all. There's only so many hours a day, and we only have so many employees working for us. So that's why it's so important that you understand the ins and outs of the police department.
I understand. I think especially because it's here at Goldman's College, and since the training is here on this campus, I figured there would be a much more or a larger connection that could be made with faculty on this campus, teaching faculty, with regards to, for example, mental wellness and classes on psychology that could be cross-listed so that officers do take the time, or the force does take the time to train effective officers, as opposed to putting them on the street. One, you know, just off of that, maybe having a critical race or racial profiling course of the history of this, in order for the individual, since they're human beings anyway, to be able to access this and understand, well, if I do approach this particular community, I at least have the background and knowledge to know where they may or may not be coming from. And, you know, I know there are certain paradigms in terms of time reference and whatnot for the training, but wouldn't that make for a better officer in the future, especially if we're looking at 10 years later, like to have the adequate training, adequate instruction, and their personal education, and bring them to the community to be educated wouldn't that make for a better, for a better department in general?
Well, I think a well-trained officer is always going to be, again, it's just how you divide the pie. There's only so many hours a day, you know, and again, we have to go to work. So, I mean, we are taking steps, you know, post mandates a certain amount. We have training in the academy, and then there's reoccurring training. My point is that there, even racial profiling, there's a litany of different subjects that also have reoccurring training, you know. It's funny, I have a distant cousin, and he holds, I don't know, 4 master's degrees, 2 doctorates. He's a professional student. At police officers, we can't be professional students because we're expected to go to work. So I don't know where the time frame comes. I think that it's good to realize that and recognize that we need training. And I think, and I'll tell you right now, in Huntington Beach, that's one thing that we're proud of. We've never, even during the tough times, we've really never suffered a cut to our training budget. We've been vigilant in that. Other departments, I think they gamble with that personally. But even with that training, though, you still need to be able to have time to go out and go to work. So that's why it's important that society, the community, recognize, hey, these guys got to learn and got to keep up on a lot of stuff. But it's not ignorance on the part of the police department. We do cover it.
Let me add to that. You know, in Huntington Beach, the police department is also doing another important aspect of learning those lessons that you're describing, because those are critical. And I would agree with you that anything you can do that can keep someone from dying on the street in an escalated situation that didn't need to escalate, because of if you can train that out of someone or teach them or put them in a situation where they can learn something that can help them be safe out there or safer, I think that's a great investment. And it has to be a balance. One of the things that Chief Handy's doing, and I think it's some of the best practices, and that is some of the community relations work he's doing. He's organized a bunch of the chiefs and started some dialogues with the LGBT community, just as an element of building on your experience besides classroom training. No offense to classroom training, but it's in the classroom, it's not in the community, and getting out there to the Oakview Collaborative like you did when you were a young man, and to some of the other community-based organizations in the neighborhoods that you're policing and engaging them on that level, having those conversations. I think those are some of the community policing and engagement practices that I've seen take place in some of the departments in Orange County. Those are some practices that I think really help to build as well that skill base that makes for a safer officer and safer policing.
Thank you.
I think what I'm hearing is that if the 21st century is the century of revolution in relationships, this is something that we all ought to do to establish new relationships and ways that we have relationships with each other. My question is, what we are experiencing, can we categorically say that these are police officers, or is it as citizens we have these kind of biases and these kind of still prejudices that we haven't overcome it, and so we wind up being in the law enforcement, you're just carrying it as a citizen, but not that it becomes more important because now as police officers, we are in charge of people, so it becomes more evident that it needs to be, we have to have breakthroughs and transforming this. But is it really a citizen problem? As citizens, we have these biases that we haven't overcome them, but it's not a categorically a law enforcement problem. Is it really as citizens we have this biases that we haven't yet overcome? And we kind of like carry it in any kind of occupation. In this case, it becomes a little bit more apparent or a little bit more evident because it's a relationship with the public. So is it as citizens we have this responsibility to overcome our separations and overcome our relationships or overcome this biases that we have in the back of our head, that we all have them, as you mentioned, that we all have them. So is it time that we all overcome this and engage in these activities and in this transformation and take responsibility to transform ourselves? Can we step back and say that this is a citizen responsibility as opposed to just categorically say that it is a responsibility of police officers? You get what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, Fran, I think what you're saying is that we all have biases and bigotry. They are manifest throughout our society. They're manifest in our families. They're manifest in our civic organizations. They're manifest on Sunday morning when we're the most segregated probably we are at any other time of the week. They're manifest in our companies and in our associations and in our religious affiliations. And I think that what you were talking about in terms of, is this all of our responsibility or is there some reason we're pointing just at police? I think the emphasis that we have on police here today in particular related to this is because we place so much, it's such an important job, and they have life and death in their hands every day they go out there. And so it becomes a more critical thing. Everything that you do as a police officer is critical. I can go about my business and do my work and not have to be faced with these decisions, these snap decisions, which may cost me my life or somebody else my life, their life. So in that critical decision making, it becomes a higher, it raises it up. But I think what you're pointing to is the responsibility we all have as a society to learn about people that are different and get past those differences, get to the point where we can start to be more understanding and embracing of those different ways of seeing the world and acting. I don't know, that was my thought.
Ashley, could you follow up on that too, your thoughts?
I think that Fran is absolutely correct. You wouldn't need as many hours targeted towards police once they're in that role if we did a better job of teaching all of society to eliminate these biases to begin with from an elementary age on. If we all had better education in that regard and shared experiences within other cultures and whatnot, I think that it would require less hours specific to their job because they would have already had that foundation just going through our education system. And so we've already talked about it. We need to change the way we're teaching some of these kids. Just like there's no classes offered in school on your rights, there's no classes offered in peace either. That's not something that you're taught growing up. What peace is, most people I think of, peace signs and hippies, and peace is fierce and it requires really deep understandings of things, and those things have to be taught. And so, yeah, I completely agree with her. I think we need to make sure, even if you can't maybe affect the curriculum that your school is teaching your child, to make sure you're teaching it at home and exposing your children to experiences in which will make them better human beings. And that way, if your child chose to become a police officer, the things that would be taught to them in these courses would have already been taught at home and they would have already had the experiences. So. However, with the given situation, I think we need to become more selective about the officers that we're choosing to hire right now and make sure, just like, you would hope you're getting an unbiased juror in that type of role. I think we need to make sure that we're hiring people who we've somehow screened, and I don't know what the right way to do that is, but make sure we're getting the people into those law enforcement roles who are already at, they already have that ingrained in them to be as least biased as possible.
Well, Jason, from
yes.
you,
yes.
What do you think are the responsibilities and the roles of a citizen in creating a fair, just, compassionate society? Aside from the law enforcement side of it,
sure.
Based on your experiences and extensive experiences that you have, what is the role of a student, citizen?
So I struggle with the terms fair and just, because they can be very subjective. That can be a moving target. But I do know how you can get a compassionate society. And we get that compassionate society through our communication, the way we communicate with each other. We talk about our implicit bias. We talk about our perceptions. We need to be more, we need to be self-reflective in that and recognize them. How does it affect me? How does it affect how I communicate? How does it affect my relationships? We need to be more mindful of that. When we're more mindful of how we can be more active in changing that and being able to address each other in a way that honors and validates each other, and that can in turn create that society that we're looking for.
You know, as I thought about the question I was asking you, I thought, you know what? It's gotta be pretty difficult to be unjust and unfair to someone and at the same time show compassion for them. Mm. Mm-hmm. So, it's kind of like that, they probably all three go together there.
Yeah.
So, does anybody else want to comment on the question that I gave? Anybody else on the panel want to comment on the question I posed to Jason? No? No? Please.
So I can ask the question differently.
Sure.
Because, we talk about hiring from different segments of society, so that we represent those different segments. We talk about the diversity of our culture. We talk about the importance of that uniqueness, all which I acknowledge. But I haven't heard any discussion about what is it that we are commonly called to be? What should unite us as Americans or as visitors to this nation? That maybe if we had more discussion around commonality of purpose, commonality of society, what it is that we're here to achieve, maybe we find some different answers. So for example, Ashley made a great observation, I thought, that we aren't teaching what it means to be a citizen. We're not teaching, at least not well, we're not teaching some of the things that, well, I was a kid going to school. We rallied on one another. I was taught that we're to love our neighbor as ourselves. I was taught that irrespective of race or color or anything else, you want to give that person an opportunity, give them a hand up. You want to make sure that you treated other people with dignity and respect. And it's almost like those values are lost values. So we talk a lot about segmenting ourselves. We're not talking very much about uniting ourselves under common themes and common values. How do we do that?
Ma'am?
Please.
I think it's a great question and objective, and it brings forth a lot of really important ideas. There's no question that our organization's chief purpose is to bring people together around their common interests. I think one of the things that we sometimes forget, though, that life isn't the same for everybody. One of the things that I came to realize somewhere along in life is that I've lived a very privileged life. Not because I'm rich, not because my parents were rich. They were not. Had a very, middle class environment. But there's all kinds of privileges that I had that, for instance, Jason didn't have. I went to a school and the assumption was that I was gonna be a good student. Jason went to a school and the assumption was that maybe he'll be a good athlete. I hope he behaves. The assumptions that are the privilege of being white, there are all kinds of assumptions that are made and expectations that are pointed at you. Jackie, as a woman, as a police chief, this is the most unusual, one of the more unusual people to rise to your rank. And for her to do that versus how you got there, there's a whole lot of different barriers that you never had to think about and you never had to get over because you're a white male, Christian, Protestant, I mean, whatever the whole package is, I don't know, that's me,
Maybe an
assumption,
yeah.
No, I pretty much know you pretty well, Rick. But I think that it's sometimes easy for us to say, if only the Oakview community, just thinking of a neighborhood here locally, or the people in Santa Anita, or the people in La Jolla, or the different communities where some of you have policed, if only they had the same respect that our core American values teach, we wouldn't be dealing with the kind of gangs and drugs and violence. But to a certain extent, we're getting an outcome there that's so consistent in terms of the young people coming up. You have to think that maybe there are other things that are happening that are outside of our experience. And we have to think of other ways and other ways to understand and figure out how to overcome those. And part of that, we do this Horatio Alger exercise. Everybody holds hands and you say, now take a step forward if you come from a two-parent family. Take a step backwards if you've been on welfare. Take a step forward if you've traveled out of the country to Europe. Take a step backward if you're, you know, if your parents are unemployed. You go through this around the assumptions that we make, and you all of a sudden I find with my staff, I've got to let go, because I'm way out there in terms of these things I never even thought of as privileges that I actually enjoyed the benefit of the doubt on and experience, and they're sitting back there having overcome all these other obstacles that I never had to do. And it's mind-boggling to think about how different some people's life experience is. And but I think all of what we want to do at OC Human Relations is figure out ways so we can create some of those experiences together and help to overcome some of those disparities in life experience and some of those things that have made it more difficult for some and easier for others. But to find that common interest, because I think as human beings, we share more in our common interest than that which divides us into our racial or other groups. But it is good to know and notice, we talk about segmenting, it's good to notice that 95% of the Latinos are washing out before they get to the end of the academy. And why is that? You know, if you have a 10% of your recruited class applicants are Latino, why is it that 95% of them wash out and only 50% of the whites in the academy wash out? And I don't know the statistics on that, but they're disturbing statistics. And I think we need to look at our academies. And this one, I'm not thinking actually of Golden West, which I'm not as familiar with, but LA Academy in particular, where my daughter's a recruiter in a police department and has had that experience with seeing those statistics. That's I think we need to look at some of that. Anyway,
I have a question. So did you and Jason? Do you guys talk about where what your expectations were in school before this meeting?
No.
Did we what? Did you guys talk about what each other's expectations were in going to school before this meeting?
No.
No, so how, this is where I have an issue from a police department standpoint. So how would, I find it irresponsible for you to just assume Jason was gonna be an athlete.
I was telling you the implicit assumptions people make about people who are African American, not the assumptions made about him. I was using the example of these are the kind of assumptions that are disproportionately made about people based on their race. Not, we were just examples, not actual.
Yeah. I think you have to be careful with this, though.
Sure.
See, because that's not how I understood it when you presented it. So the way you presented
my apologies.
Yeah, okay, because this is an issue, because we have policies and sometimes even laws that are enacted based on that statement in and of itself. I'll give you a little bit of history about me. I grew up in Huntington Beach. I was born in San Pedro, which is in the south end of Los Angeles, right?
South Bay, yeah.
Very diversified. Mm-hmm. So every weekend I would spend at my grandmother's house. Mm-hmm. Lots of diversity. Grew up in Huntington Beach, which is predominantly white. And I decided to become a policeman in South Central Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. You know, so I listened to some of these things, like some of the statements as far as people being stopped because the only reason they're black. I worked Newton in 77th Division in the 1990s. Mm-hmm. That's all we had. There was nobody else to stop except for blacks and Hispanics. Mm-hmm. So I did not see the bias. When I worked Newton Division in 1990, the RD, the reporting district there, they had a reporting district that was the most violent in the city, okay? People, every day, drive-bys, kids getting shot.
The city had obtained a grant in order to put barricades up in the streets and put officers on foot within the reporting district. We had protesters come down from outside of the city to protest against the police involvement and how oppressive we were. But you know, the citizens that lived there, they loved it because their kids could go out and play and not get shot. So I think that as society, before we start making these assumptions, that we owe it to actually find out the facts. And like Chief Lomberg said, the research behind it. I think that as, and I'm not speaking as a law enforcement officer, I'm speaking now as a citizen. We have to slow down. We all have to slow down and actually get to the truth of the matter. When we go off half-cocked, emotional, we make bad decisions. And sometimes with money, we influence the wrong people. And then we implement policies that we might regret later. So I think that as society, absolutely, education is beautiful from beginning on. But we have to slow down when we're coming down to making some of these decisions. And I'll tell you, in doing this for 25 years, I've seen decisions be made in the police department that we shake our heads, and they were political decisions. And absolutely, we'll go ahead and we'll change gears and we'll go all to one particular direction because of one particular fallacy.
Sure.
Okay. So, but I think that if there's a bias or whatever, maybe there is, maybe there isn't. I can tell you with me, I get a little bit offended when people tell me I'm biased because I'm not. I don't know the difference. You know, I was a little bit offended by hearing early on African American church. What is that? That's kind of like an oxymoron. I mean, I thought a church is just a church. It's open to everybody. Mm-hmm. That's the way I learned about it. Am I wrong? Mm-hmm. So
Yes. The answer is yes, you are wrong. And it's maybe it's outside your experience.
It probably is.
But it's a common expression. And I would suggest that even though you're, have a tremendous ability to not express bias and have had this incredible experience working in a difficult, violent, predominantly African-American community, as you describe, or whatever, however you're describing San Pedro.
It wasn't.
Even though you have that experience, if I can finish my thought, to suggest that ergo there is not racial profiling, that there is not a bias that comes into place in Huntington Beach, because when you were hired in Huntington Beach, after Robitel had already retired, I think.
1992.
Is that, when Earl stepped down?
86. Lomberg hired me. I can vouch for that one.
No, I'm just...
I've got the picture to prove it.
Yeah. No, I just try to place it in history with the policing practices, which changed dramatically with Ron and some of his predecessors 10 years before, that time. And today, it is a prevalent feeling in the African American community that they get stopped more frequently than other people. And I would bet dimes that you could not get any one of the instructors here to tell you anything different than an actual fact is that African Americans are brought under more scrutiny. That the way, in fact, Gary's thought there about you can, the laws are so thick that there's something wrong with everybody, and a motor cop is looking to is doing his or her job. They come upon a situation. If that person they come upon is African American versus white, I would hold that it's more likely that African American, that motor officer is going to go all the way down those 400 pages to find a reason to stop that African American in that particular community than that white one. That's where the implicit bias comes in. Not that he can't find a reason, but that he looks harder for a reason to stop him. And that's just a fact. And it's not everybody, it's not all the time, it's not intentional, and it's not done in a nefarious way. This is part of being a human being, and that's what implicit bias is. It gets you thinking about looking for something wrong and more intently when your unconscious bias comes in and affects the decision. That's what I would hold. And I think that, you know, your experience, I didn't mean to insult or suggest that that's not legitimate experience and that you can't be an incredibly, effective individual working your day without putting any bias in what you do. I have no basis to make any judgment or statement. I assume the opposite in the fact that what I've heard from you and seen from you here. So, that's definitely not what I meant to either paint you or everybody with any of that brush. It's the same brush I would paint myself with in terms of the way in which our implicit biases come into affecting our behavior on a day-to-day basis.
But my point is, I think we have to be careful when we're swiping that brush, because when you swipe that brush over the police department, remember, those police departments are filled with human beings.
Absolutely.
They are human beings first. Every police officer is also a human being. So you have a human being in there who, like myself, I don't have bias. Who knows what my ancestry is? Trust me. I can't afford to have a bias. But, you know, so when you do that, when you insult officers at the core of their human being, of their being, and I think that's kind of the important thing. I think that's why the community...
I try really hard not to do that.
I know a lot of people don't, but I think a lot of people forget it. I mean, it's as simple as... I'll tell you a funny story. It's as simple as you walk into a restaurant to eat. Mm-hmm. I've had this. And, you know, the first thing is they look at you and they go, is everything okay? Yeah, other than we're just hungry. Because we haven't eaten all day. Sometimes I think the public, they lose fact that we're human beings. I think they do. They look at us, they see the uniform, they see the badge, people focus on the gun, and they go, oh, it's the police. You know, but they, you know, if you spent a weekend with me at my house, you wouldn't see John, the police officer, anymore. You'd see a human being. And I think that's why, you know, I think these citizens academies, these community forums, these things where we have to get to know each other, I think that's important. And I think a lot of the racial profiling and some of those things, I think that a lot more of that will not be as close to the top, because people will realize it's really not as true in their own mind because they've learned the other side of it. You know, part of all this is also, and I'm sure a word Jason probably use in his profession, is compromise. Hmm. Am I along the line wrong? There's a sense of compromise. You know, it's not about, you know, the police department, we're part of the community just like everybody else is. You know, we reflect the community and everything else. We're human beings. Sometimes we might disagree, but part of how you get through that is dealing with a compromise. What's more important, like racial profiling or mental illness training? It's all about the communication, though.
Those are both critical.
Yeah. So.
And both of those are costing people's lives if we don't get them right.
Well, yeah.
But. So I just would like to add in that I think part of the problem is that in our quest to not have bias, it doesn't help to say that we don't have bias. You have bias. We all have bias. It's just in all of us. So when you can't admit to the problem, it's hard to fix the problem. And when I call it a problem, I'm saying it is a problem that we all have. So we have to scrutinize ourselves, in what ways am I biased, and in what ways can I fix it, overcome it, control it, whatever it may be, especially when you are in uniform and you are to treat people equally. So it's difficult for me to hear you say that you don't have bias. You do, we all do. So we need to first admit it so that we can address it. You should constantly be scrutinizing yourself. In what way am I being biased right now?
Well, I would disagree with that completely. I don't think I don't have the right to tell you or anybody else how you're feeling or what you feel, unless I have implicit data or research or statistic to prove everything. I think that's irresponsible. I think that's part of the problem with our society now, is we do have people telling us what we're supposed to feel. We're human beings. You're going to feel the way you feel. And then what we have to do is we all have to learn to feel that way together. I've known people that I don't think are biased. I don't believe I'm biased. For somebody to tell me, well, you know you are, you just have to research it. I mean, there are things that I don't like, but I don't hold that against somebody.
Out of respect for everybody's time, it's coming to that point in time, though, because I do want to give each of the panelist members an opportunity to kind of sum some things up of what their thoughts are. And if it fits in your closing arguments, if you would, if you could mention one thing, that if the city of Huntington Beach had a huge incident in which there became a huge division between the police department and community members, I'm confident that Huntington Beach has a great relationship with their police department. But if something was to happen to make that not be so anymore, in your closing arguments, would you just comment what one thing, what do you think the first step should be that police and citizens should do to start to mend that relationship? Jason, can we start with you, and then we're just going to go through just a little bit and then kind of wrap up as respect for everybody's time.
Absolutely. I'll just say this. I think the exchange that took place here and with the audience, I think that is a prime example of why a conflict resolution specialist or a mediator, I'll say it, would be necessary. You know, when we talk about the initial exchange between John, yourself, and Rusty, Rusty made an example dealing with assumptions. I understood exactly what he was saying, but you took it a different way. And that is why a mediator or a conflict resolution specialist would be helpful in a situation to help reframe, to make sure that, you know, you understood where he was coming from when you may not have initially. And that happens all the time because, you know, obviously we communicate differently. We know what we're going to say more so or quicker than the other person who's hearing it is hearing what we're saying. So I think that's very, very important that we understand that and be mindful that, you know, when it comes to situations where there is a rift, where there is a conflict, sometimes we say things and it comes out differently than the way we intend, or it's received differently than the way we intend. And so it's important to have someone there that can effectively reframe, that can effectively remold and situate things and posit things in a way that is consumable for everyone without taking away the main point that was being shared. But in order for everyone to receive it, and for everyone to understand each other, and that's what we're talking about here when we communicate. We're communicating so that we can understand each other. When we understand each other, we realize that there are things that unite us. We all have psychological needs that need to be met. You know, whether we want to have some autonomy, some type of control over our environment, over our circumstances, over our situations. Our need of affiliation. We want to feel like we belong to something. We want to feel like we're a part of something. The feeling of having a fulfilling role in that collective. We all have those. Those are uniting things that we all need, and we all want that. And so a conflict resolution specialist, or a mediator in this case, could be very helpful in creating that dialogue and shaping and positing that dialogue so that we can reach those and see that we all have things that in common while addressing our differences. So that is what I would say would be necessary if there is a rift, if there is a conflict between community members and law enforcement.
So I'm gonna go back to something I mentioned earlier, and I think the most important thing for us all to do is to get money out of politics. I'm gonna keep pushing that one all day long. Because no matter what you say you want to see changed, I think it needs to come from, unfortunately, this is the way we're set up, top down right now. I didn't hear anybody here say, you know, hey, we don't want to give more training. Just doesn't sound like they're allocated the time or funds to give more training, to get more training. So, you know, the way that you change that is you make your vote count, and right now it doesn't. I'm gonna reiterate that there is zero correlation between what you want, no matter what it is, and what the federal government does currently. So I think before we address any other issues, that has to be the first one to get money out of politics, to make room for your voice to count, your ideas to be heard and acted upon. Further to that, I wanna say that I think it's a very dangerous thing to be blind to things like, not understanding what a black church is. I wish more than anything that we didn't currently have black churches or white churches. I wish that wasn't the scenario, and I wish that we didn't call them that currently. I understand the historical reference, I wish that wasn't what we were calling them now. I do think we will move on beyond that where, you know, things are just a church. But right now, that is the situation, is we do have, you know, churches that are predominantly Black or predominantly white, and they are still called that. And so rather than being blind to the current situation or saying that you don't, you know, identify or understand what that is, okay, I do understand what it is. I will, you know, maybe reach across the boundaries and venture to the next community or start attending another church if you attend. Whatever it is that you want to do to change it. But in the meantime, you know, I used to say when I was young that I'm colorblind, I don't see race. And I was just naive, I was fooling myself. Everybody sees race, and it's important that you do, because when you stop looking and seeing how people of different races are affected, if you say you're blind to race, then absolutely you can't see what's happening to those other races. That's different from what's happening to you if you don't see the race. So I think that's important, and I just want to say thank you to the people that did come out today. I wish we had a bigger turnout, but Fran is absolutely correct. In a low turnout actually just means there's that much more work to do, and to get behind this that much more fiercely. And everybody should bring a friend to the next one. And just if they bring a friend and they bring a friend, keep talking about this. We absolutely cannot make any change with this many empty seats. So help others get involved, help them understand why it's important, and make sure they know it goes beyond signing online petitions and stuff, and Facebook posts. Those are all things you can do, but you actually have to get up and be involved in things.
I love that expression, back when I was young. That really makes me feel old when you say that.
I'm going to focus pretty much on the strategies for healing after a significant event. And a lot of that has been going on in the news, obviously, with the incident in Baltimore and Ferguson, obviously. And it goes all the way back to LAPD and the Rodney King incident. I think first and foremost, you have to be proactive. As a police department, we have to train our officers on how to effectively use force and understanding the law and what goes along with that. As far as the citizenry, I think that we have to have forums like this. I think we have to have town hall meetings. I think we have to do a much better job educating the citizens as far as the laws and how we're trained. You know, it's no big secret. I mean, I think it's very important that the citizens understand how we're trained. I'll give you a for instance, and I know Ron and I talked about this. You know, right now, my personal opinion is, you know, we're kind of broken in law enforcement. You know, when it comes to use of force, you know, and this is kind of my caveat when I teach it, most of what's taught in the police academies and the continuing training is all geared around pain compliance. It's all geared around pain compliance. Right?
Yeah.
Almost 90% of the people we enter into use of force with, they don't feel pain. Yeah. So you have to come up with another deal. So, I mean, fortunately, I think at the Huntington Beach Police Department, we've done a good job. We've identified what works. We have restraint systems, and we've taught our officers how to deal with incapacitation versus pain and everything else, but society needs to understand that, because right now they believe what they see on TV, that you can go and punch somebody and they're out and they're knocked out for a considerable amount of time, when that is not accurate. That is not what occurs. Okay, that's first and foremost. Now, I think if it does hit, I think the best thing is to be out front. We have to emphasize patience and justice, and on both sides. I think Jason can attest to this. You know, there's rights of everybody involved in it. The police department, the police officers involved in a significant event, as well as the citizenry, everybody's afforded the same amount, the same type of due process rights. I think as human beings, we tend to be impatient for the most part, so we want immediate justification. But we have a system in place, and that system has to work on both sides of it. So I think we have to push that issue. Don't fall victim to emotional or emotional requests. It's difficult to go out there as a manager in a police department. I never want to give an emotional statement that might be later incorrect, because it's harder to go back on that. I watch the news and some of these things, and I see chiefs of police or county officials, and they make statements, and they're more emotionally driven, and then they play hell trying to go back there and then recorrect it without looking like there's some sort of deceit. Mm-hmm. So in closing, though, you know, it's funny, when I was thinking about this stuff, Chuck had brought the question, and what does a just, fair, and compassionate community look like? And I thought for a minute, and I thought, that's pretty theoretical, actually. I mean, I think we all have a different idea. But the best thing I can come up with is actually from the old poem, Everything I Learned and Needed to Know in Life, I Learned in Kindergarten. You guys remember that? So I'll close with that. Share everything, play fair, don't hit people. Put things back where you found them, clean up your own mess. Don't take things that aren't yours. Say you're sorry when you hurt somebody. Wash your hands before you eat. Flush. Warm cookies and cold milk are good for you. Live a balanced life. Learn some and think some. And draw and paint and sing and dance. And play and work every day some. Take a nap every afternoon. And when you go out in the world, watch for traffic. Hold hands, stick together. Be aware of wonder. I don't know what happens after kindergarten, but it all seems pretty simple. That's all I got.
I'm awed by the eloquence of my...
I didn't make that up.
No. I, you know, there's very little new in the world. And I'm much appreciative of the of that message, as well as yours and yours, Jason, Ashley. You know, in thinking back to Rodney King and the riots and stuff, at that time I was asked by Post to serve on a committee to come up with curriculum for use of force, supervisory responsibility, and cultural awareness. And we spent a week in San Diego in some hotel, you know, trying to come up with that. And I think today we're looking at those same issues. And I think that the classroom training's an important part of that, but I think there's more than that, and some of the ways in which that happens. Now, in the question that you posed, Chuck, I think in a critical situation when trust is broken down, I think you have to employ all of your allies to make contact with people in the community and sit down one at a time, and then in small groups, and then larger groups, and find that conversation. Start the conversation about, you know, what happened, why did it happen, how can we prevent it, what's the worst, what do we need to repair, how can we fix it, how do we prevent this from happening again. It's the relationship built out of respect for each individual, understanding and listening deeply, listening to what people have to say, and learning from that as you go forward. So, I mean, that's, and I think all of the things that were suggested by the other panelists, I think, are brilliant. So I can barely add to them. So that's all.
While you were talking, you know, and you read John, you know, read the last pieces. Just it dawned on me again a poem from Rumi that says, "Beyond the field of right and wrong, there is a place called love, and I will meet you there." So I think what as peace study sees these things, instead of always seeing ourselves as you versus me, us versus them, when there is a problem, it would be nice to be able to see it from. It's you and I, like one word, versus the problem. It's the injustices that we want to overcome, not people. It's that's, if I learned anything from teaching about civil rights, you know, I learned that it was the injustices that is important for us to get united to defeat that, as opposed to defeating each other. This phrase, being the change, changes the being. It speaks to me always that, you know, if we be the voice of that, and that would change our being, and we would be able to see, we'll be able to see how we could create one word, not you and I, like you and I, one word versus the problem, and get this resolved. Because I think it is time. It is time. It is not because we would be impatient, but I think it is time for all of us to get united, like Rick said, and get united and work against the problem, not against each other. And I would really, I would love to see that. I would love to see more conversations. The next conversation we're gonna have is Tuesday, November 4th. We have already set that up, and we will definitely full force go after it. We need these kind of conversations, just because the lack of it right now, it concerns me. And I would love to see more talks, more intimate settings and intimate conversations to happen, and that would change our being. I just caught myself yesterday. My biases was there, you know, and I would like to think of myself that I don't have one, but it was there. I checked myself. It was live, and it was there. So, you know, brought tears to my eyes, but it was there. So I had to think about myself and each corner of my brain and my mind to see that it's there, and I, you know, we are human beings, and not to make ourselves bad and wrong about it, but the more we notice them and transform them, that's what matters, and the more we can transform this in our society, that would matter. And I would really like to invite everybody to look into ourselves, not from the eyes of judgment, but the eyes of we are human beings, and what are mind we have them, and that's the best way to combat them. So November 4th, Wednesday, it's a Wednesday, November 4th. I hope that you will help us to put a things together that speaks to students. I would love to see them being here. That would enrich the conversation. That would make a difference. So while I really, really appreciate from the bottom of my heart everybody who's here and it's participating in this, I really thank you. And anyone who helped us to put it together, including all four of you that have been generously giving your time to us. And thank you for all your generosity. Please, let's keep on going. Thank you. Thank you all.
So nice to meet you.
Thank you.